Put your hand in the hand of the man who steals the water. Put your hand in the hand of the man who calms the sea. There's a clue. Take a look at yourself. You can look at others differently. Put your hand in the hand of the man from Galilee. Every time I look into the holy book, I want to tremble. Should be. So put your hand in the hand of the man who steals the water. Put your hand in the hand of the man who calms the sea. Take a look at yourself. You can look at others differently. Put your hand in the hand of the man from Galilee. Pray before I reach the age of 7. And when I'm down on my knees, that's when I'm closest to heaven. Daddy lived his life, 2 kids and a wife. You do, you must do. And then I can't remember what the real line is. Here you go,
this part.
So put your hand in the hand of the man. So put your hand in the hand of the man who sealed the water. Put your hand in the hand of the man who calmed the sea.
You sound good.
Take a look at yourself. You can look at others differently. Put your hand in the hand of the man from Galilee.
Woo! Peace Church, you sound good singing this morning. Maybe it's the rainy day. I don't know, but I think I see Tracy Revoir on the Zoom singing along as well. We see you singing, Tracy. I love it. So good morning, everyone, whether you are at home or in your car on Zoom. In our big, big, expansive community, or right down here in Kansas City at our worship space. You are welcome here. We come here every week, rain or shine, to sing together, to pray, to greet one another, and to listen for a word of God's good hope and peace for the world. If you're able, please stand and we'll sing our opening. It was new last week, so we're still kind of getting our sea legs. So the words are printed in your bulletin and also on the screen.
Come and sing a simple song of freedom. Sing it like you've never sung before.
Continue singing together our opening hymn, Spirit, which is on your bulletin or on the screen.
Spirit.
For the Spirit of God that stirs us and calls us and asks us to reach deep and pull out the very best of who we are so that we can keep building a world of peace and justice and joy for all. Thankful for this gift of this community. The peace of God be with you all.
And also with you.
Please share a sign of peace, a word of peace with those around you. Peace, peace. Good to see you. Peace. Good to be here together. Thank you so much. You can be seated. And it's wonderful to see a nice big Zoom crowd up there too, and to have, I think we've got maybe almost 10 little kids back in the back too, so that's a gift, and we're thankful for Peggy for stepping up and sharing with them. It's back to school time, and whether we have little ones or little ones are way grown up, it's always a reminder that we're called to be lifelong learners, that we're called to continue to grow and to be a community that keeps trying to expand our witness and the way we can be a sign of hope and peace in the world. So thankful for you all for being here, for reminding us of all that we can share. We want to be sure we know that you're here, so please take the green book and pass it down. If you're on Zoom, let us know that you're here through the chat. You can also let us know of any joys or concerns that we might not be aware of in either of those places, and you can make your offering in the basket or on the Zoom link. We have some wonderful joys to celebrate. A big one is that Marcus and Angela, raise your hand, are going to be married today at 3 o'clock. Yay. So we're excited. We're looking forward to that celebration today. And we think of the Pendletons, whose daughter Allie was married yesterday in Texas outside. So we're hopeful that everybody's had a delightful time. And we've got lots of people traveling. Stephanie Olson is leaving tonight to go to Greece for 2 weeks. So we're excited about that. Yeah, with her two daughters, one who just graduated from college and the other one out in California. So you have a wonderful time. And Jane Fissler Hoffman is in Angola with her church, with the UCC. So we're thinking of her. And it's great to see lots of kids, lots of youth, and we're super thankful and always thankful to have State Senator Cindy Holscher with us whenever we can get her here from Kansas, trying to hold back the crazy there while we try to hold it back in Missouri, which is, you know, a full-time job. But anyway. And then we have some things that are joy and concern. Our own Micah Holmes is still at Children's Mercy, having another round of chemotherapy, and hoped he would be home yesterday. Goes back in for a little more chemotherapy this week, and then he's got a little break before his big surgery, 10-hour surgery on August 28th to do that. And we're going to do some really cool things for that. We'd like everybody to make like little posters and things that we'll put in Peace News too, but like an 8.5 by 11 sheet. So they can kind of plaster KU, or you can make something bigger too. So to celebrate that and to be a source of support and recovery while he's in the hospital for a little bit, recovering from pretty big surgery to remove a tumor and take a bone out of his leg and put it there in his jaw. So we're thinking of you all. Sue Elmaker lost her sister, and there was a funeral yesterday for that. Beth Jordan and Julie Clark both lost their Aunt Andrea. So they've been in Indiana, and then Todd Smith has eye surgery tomorrow, so I know you're eager to have that pass wherever you're sitting right now. But over here. So we'll be thinking of you. And we think of the folks in Maui. We know some people live there part of the year, and it's just a devastating situation. And we hope that these situations, too, will remind us about climate change and what we can do and how to dig in and how to try to help the earth kind of be a little in a gentler, kinder place for all of us. So we'll think of that. And speaking of, the scripture today is sort of about chaos. There's a lot in the scripture about water, and sometimes we miss it, but in the ancient world, the sea, the ocean was really a place of anxiety and terror, and that's why there's so much stuff about water in the scripture. You know, we tend to think, you know, oh, the earth and the biblical stories is, you know, created out of nothing, but the Greek and the Hebrew is really more kind of a created out of chaos. So it's more this sense that God was able to kind of, that there's a creative force that takes the chaos and the turbulence and maybe even the trauma and the terror in the world, and from it brings something beautiful. So our intention for the week is to think about our own lives and to think about how are the ways and what are the gifts we have that can help in a world of some chaos, especially with our young, to try to shape that and try to bring the best that we can from it. So that's our intention as we sing our call to prayer.
Please pray with me. Today, dear Lord, we come with open hearts to hear your words that help us deal in a world of chaos. During vacation, as many others, I got to see the beauty that you created and the calm that was so beautiful. But all good things come to an end, and I was back to reality, to a life that's far from perfect. But today we come with all those things that are heavy on our hearts that only you know about, relationships that are in turmoil, disappointments in ourselves and others when things don't work out the way we think they should, losses in our community, losses of jobs, an officer being shot in the line of duty, families dealing with cancer, strokes, and the list goes on and on. But yet your underlying love gives us hope for changes in small and big ways. I love the tradition of blessing the backpacks for our children because I feel that it gives us new hope for the new school year. I love the theme at my school this year, Growing Greatness. Today, we ask in prayer that we are encouraged through Holly's message as she gives us inspiration from your word to help our peace community to find peace in our chaos and to continue growing greatness in a world of unknown. Amen.
So our lesson today is from the 14th chapter of Matthew. It's this familiar story, really, of Jesus stilling the storm. This is a story that's repeated by other gospel writers. So there's sort of like some kernel here that they each take and massage and kind of use to speak to their community about whatever is going on in the community at the time. Immediately, Jesus made the disciples get into the boat and go on ahead to the other side while Jesus dismissed the crowds. And after he had dismissed the crowds, like twice we're told he dismissed the crowds, right? Like the point is, people go away, right? I'm tired of you. I mean, it's underlined. When evening came, he was there alone. But by the time the boat, battered by the waves, was far from the land, for the wind was against them. And early in the morning, Jesus came walking toward them on the sea. But when the disciples saw him walking on the sea, they were terrified, saying, "It is a ghost." And they cried out in fear. But immediately Jesus spoke to them and said, "Take heart, it is I, do not be afraid." And Peter answered him, "Lord, if it is you, command me to come to you on the water." And Jesus said, "Come." So Peter got out of the boat and started walking on the water and came toward Jesus. But when he noticed the strong wind, he became frightened and beginning to sink, he cried out, "Lord, save me." Jesus immediately reached out his hand and caught him, saying to him, "You of little faith, why did you doubt?" When they got into the boat, the wind ceased, and those in the boat worshiped him, saying, "Truly, you are the Son of God." She was so anxious about her teenage son. She was waiting on our table in a little diner in Chicago, and while she poured the coffee, she told us that he was starting to middle school this coming week, and he was autistic, and she was really worried about how he would do. She herself had been a teacher, and her husband was a teacher, and she knew how rough school could be for kids, especially middle school. She'd actually quit her job teaching to take this job as a waitress so she could be off in time to pick her son up right after school. And she told us about how she and her husband were trying to navigate the morning drop-off and all the concerns she had. And even though there was a line out the door, people waiting for a table, and even though she'd just given Joe a to-go coffee trying to get us to move along, she just kept breaking open her heart and pouring out all of her concerns and worries. And I don't know, because maybe it was the three of us at the table kept nodding, and many of us were in education and listening, but she was just so incredibly worried and anxious. Sometimes it feels like the stories in the scripture are so far away from us and have nothing to do with us. But then when you scratch a little bit, you see often that people are people, you know, and that these followers that Jesus talked about, the stories, are really kind of close to home. You know, the people in this scripture are struggling with their own anxiety and terror and worry. That is what all the stories about water in the scripture are about, whether it's Noah and the ark, or whether it's parting the Red Sea, or whether it's Jesus stilling the storm. The water was a sign for the people about this power and turbulence and chaos that they struggled to manage. So this story shows up four times in the Gospels. Mark and John tell it, and Matthew told it earlier in chapter 8. Do you all remember? We probably heard it a few months ago. And in that story, they talk about the storm, and the hurricane was actually, the word is an earthquake. I mean, it's a way of saying, I mean, people's lives are being ripped open and they don't know what to do. But in that story, Jesus is with them in the boat. This story in chapter 14 is trickier, because Jesus has sent them out onto the water so he can go pray and have a little peace and quiet. So they're out all alone adrift. And if you want to be clear, they're far away. The Greek here is the word stadia. It's like stadiums. They're stadiums away. They are way out in the water, far from the land, like too far to swim. And the scripture tells us that the boat is not just being battered and buffeted. That's what the English says. But the Greek is really tortured. The boat is being tortured. And the people there knew a little bit about that too. Remember, Paula last week preached a beautiful sermon about the reason Jesus needed a break was because he just fed 5,000, and he'd also just lost his friend Herod, who, you know, his friend John the Baptist, Herod had chopped his head off. So the people knew something about torture, which is not unlike many parts of our own world as well, and not unlike many of our parents too. I thought about the waitress. I thought about parents in our church. Whether you've got a 2-year-old you're worried about, or a 22-year-old you're worried about, the word tortured. I mean, have you ever laid in bed at night and thought, you know, this is really hard, this is really difficult, and had that little mindful compassion, all the world is suffering, everyone suffers, we can try. I mean, it's just that when you have felt tortured over a child, I mean, there's nothing like that. There's nothing like worrying about your kid. So there's this, you know, they're out there alone, they're feeling tortured, and then Jesus starts walking to them on the water. Well, this is a good thing, right? I mean, we see that and we think, how did he walk on the water? Because we're all about gravity and that kind of thing. They're thinking, how's he managing the chaos? That's what that means to them. So they're afraid. Jesus comes walking to them. He's stilling it, he's calming it. And then he calls them to do the same. He calls them to step out of the boat. So they start trying to do that, and Peter does, and he sinks. And it sounds like he's being scolded, you have little faith, but the Greek here, again, is really more about not so much faith versus doubt, but vacillating. I mean, that speaks to us. Sometimes we believe, you know, we think, we feel calm, and then sometimes we're like terrified. I mean, it's that kind of a world. And in the end, though, Jesus kind of gives him this hope and sense, and then the disciples fall down and worship him. Courageous Sailing is a place in Boston that my son worked for 3 summers when he was in college. And some of you have heard me talk about it. It's one of the most remarkable not-for-profits I have ever seen. And their whole goal was really to help kids learn to manage the chaos around them. It's kind of like a YMCA of sailing. They have a really large spot there on Boston Harbor. And then they have several other locations around Boston. Ben spent his first 2 summers at Camp Harborview, which taught kids who were extremely low income how to sail and do other things. They had 400 kids at a time for 4 weeks. The parents paid $5 for the program. They were there all day. They did all kinds of things, all kinds of activities, but there's something about teaching a kid to sail, teaching a kid, little kid, how to manage a boat on the water, how to keep it going in all the conditions. I mean, there's something about that that just gives you a sense of self-esteem and confidence that's just incredible. And then the whole program is designed to have the kids grow up and become instructors themselves and then go to college and all of this. And it was just a life-changing experience, not just for the kids, but for the sailing instructors like my son, not just to see how kids' lives could be changed, but to also be around remarkable mentors. I have never been around an organization absolutely more positive. And there was a guy there named Mark Lindsay, and if there is anyone who walks on water, it's Mark Lindsay. He was fortunate. When he was 14, his parents gave him a boating kit, and he made his first boat. He happened to be brilliant and smart and creative, and he went to UPenn, and then he went to MIT, and he became one of the premier boat builders in the country. He built some of the ships that were used to race in America's Cup, and he built luxury yachts, and he built just incredibly fine boats. But he was the kind of person who was the life of the party. He would come in, he would smile, he would hug. He was incredibly competitive, remarkable sailor and boat builder, but just incredible collaborator, always wanted to gather together with other people. When he was in his 60s, he joined a frostbite fleet, which is people who are absolutely crazy and insist on sailing, you know, in the harbor when it's middle of December and January and freezing. And he learned about courageous. He learned that the fleet he was sailing with was a bunch of courageous sailors. Long story, he became on the board of directors, and then he became the chair, and then he began gathering all these resources, and then he like moved the organization from serving this number of kids to this number of kids, and he had this most remarkable vision. He died suddenly from a health event about 4 years ago, and Ben had just gone back to college, and I remember he called me because this was just such a remarkable human being, and then there were just all kinds of emails flooding in to Courageous about this person. And I've held on to his vision for Courageous because it makes me think about so many of you. Like, you could take the word courageous out and you could put Boy Scouts or Kauffman Academy or Cherith Brook. You could just insert any of your schools because it's really not about the sailing program. It's about what they're trying to teach the kids. And now if you look at their website, like front and center, Mark Lindsay's vision. Courageous will be a national model for innovation and best practices in youth development. We will increase opportunity and reduce achievement gaps for youth from marginalized and low-income households. We will grow a diverse and inclusive community of youth from all backgrounds. We will nurture and inspire our students' academic achievement and social-emotional growth. We will build this on a foundation of excelling experience in which the acquisition of hard skills is tied necessarily and intentionally to broader outcomes. And the broader outcomes, of course, we're helping kids to learn to manage chaos. We're helping kids who are coming from really turbulent backgrounds. In many ways, backgrounds that might have had a lot of terror, a lot of trauma, a lot of angst in them. How to manage this and soar and become people who could live out their greatest gifts. The good thing about learning to manage the chaos is it doesn't take a boat. It really doesn't take much more than a bench. Because on the other side of the world from Boston, there's another person who walks on water, and his name is Dr. Dixon Chibanda. and he's a psychiatrist in Zimbabwe. And if you put your historic hat on, you can remember that Zimbabwe, down in the south of Africa, is one of those countries that was under colonial rule by the British Empire, was ruled by white domination. Imagine a country in which a minority of people are white, but they have all of the resources. And it's so difficult for our sisters and brothers in southern Africa across the continent to merge with a democracy when so many things have been held back from them. And that's been one of the countries that has just been in utter chaos. We think about inflation last year in this country was 8%. Inflation in Zimbabwe last year, 104%. It's just a totally different kind of reality. And when I was living in Southern Africa in 2006, Zimbabwe was just in just utter terror and chaos, trying to replace Robert Mugabe, the dictator, and all of this. And there was a massive mental health crisis in the country. Dr. Chibanda was one of the psychiatrists. And like our country, they have a shortage of psychiatrists. But in that country, they have one psychiatrist for every 1.5 million people. That's a different kind of shortage. But he, as a community health worker, was trying to figure out a way to like help people deal with the chaos. So he went to the doctors and nurses and thought, you know, they can just add to their, you know, when they're meeting with patients to try to do screening and figure out about mental health. And they were like, we're dealing with people with HIV and malaria, we can't do it. So the solution was non-professionals. And so he decided that he would figure out a way to use grandmothers as the mental health counselors in Zimbabwe. He started off with a pilot project with 14 grandmothers, and they were pretty suspicious and skeptical of Dr. Chibanda because he came in there with all of his medical terminology and his DSM-5 and talking about depression, and they said, nobody here has depression. If you talk that way, people will think you're crazy. But what they do have is something called Kafunga Sisi, which means thinking too much. And when you break down thinking too much, guess what? It's a lot like depression, right? So they started off and he had to look at some of his other lingo too, like mental health bench. We're gonna have this mental health bench where the grandmothers and the patients will meet. And they're like, if you call it the mental health bench, nobody's gonna come. So they changed the name to the friendship bench. And then they started working on just some basic skills. It was really a type of therapy, cognitive behavioral therapy, but it was grounded in relationship. It was grounded in mutual sharing. So unlike our Western model where, you know, the therapist holds back, this is like sharing. You know, the grandparents, the grandmother share, the patient share. And it was really based on a skill of summarizing. Like if you can summarize, it's a sign that you have heard the person. So the grandmothers who were the best at summarizing turned out to be the best of the therapists. And then they had other diagnostic tools. People would list out their problems. The average client would present with something like this. I'm HIV positive, I'm in an abusive relationship, I'm unemployed, I can't pay my kids' school fees. And the grandmother would sit down with the patient and help them choose one problem to focus on. And they would focus on the problem, unemployed, not the symptom, anxiety. And this friendship bench was really just the entry point, because from that, there were other ways of being connected in the community. Like the grandmother, well, I'll pray with you at church, or I'll see you in the market on Saturday. And every single person who came to the friendship bench was also put into a support group. And this has been 17 years now. Now they have 600 trained grandmothers. Now they have 50 peer-reviewed journal articles, including one in the American Medical Association. And the friendship bench works better than traditional therapy. And now 30,000 people have been reached and trained. And his goal is like Mark Lindsay's vision. Mark Lindsay wanted to touch every single kid in the Boston area who was struggling. And Dr. Chibandi's vision is just this simply, that every single person in the country would be within walking distance of a friendship bench. I remembered that because I keep thinking about our sanctuary here. And of all the holy things about it, our stained glass, the beautiful, beautiful Zoom that we look at, and this incredible, incredible altar where we see God's people walk by. But we also have the friendship bench over here. And almost every Sunday, if you hang around long enough and all the chairs get put away, we have our grandmother Mars sitting over here, right? She is. She's right there. And what's around her? The little kids and the teenagers. And Mars is just sitting there with all these loving people at her feet. I mean, I keep thinking about the friendship benches in my life. I think about Cherith Brook, the bench outside there, or Micah. I think about the pickleball, the benches. I think about where the mom's group meets and all of the things. I mean, this story is really not about you need a boat or a bench to manage the chaos, right? It's really about you need to put yourself out there. back to school time, a good time to be reminded of that, right? We can all do more. We can all offer ourselves more. We can also reach out there even when we're like Peter, I have no friggin' idea what to do, which is most of the days, right? It's not about being perfect or knowing or being sure. It's about just stepping out there and offering ourselves and risking that and believing that we have something in our experience, in our life, that we can offer to others just as we receive from them. So may this story of people who were anxious and afraid and uncertain at times, and many of us can identify, the story about people who just reached out, stepped out on the water, and offered themselves, remind us to do the same. Amen.
Amen, amen. Thank you, Holly.
It really breaks my heart to see a dear old friend go down to the worn-out place again. Do you know the sound of a closing door? Have you heard that sound somewhere before? Do you wonder if she knows you anymore? I wrapped your love around me like a chain, but I never was afraid that it would die. You can dance in a hurricane, but only if you're standing in the eye. Where did you learn to walk? Where did you learn to run away from everything you love? And did you think the bottle would ever ease your pain? Did you think that love's a foolish game? Did you find someone else to take the blame? I wrapped your love around me like a chain, but I never was afraid that it would die. You can dance in a hurricane, but only if you're standing in the eye. You can dance in a hurricane, but only if you're standing in the eye. I am a sturdy soul, and there ain't no shame in lying down in the bed you made. Can you fight the urge to run for another day? You might make it further if you learn to stay. Wrapped your love around me like a chain, but I never was afraid that it would die. You can dance in a hurricane, but only if you're standing in the eye. You can dance in a hurricane, but only if you're standing in the eye.
For showing us the way to live in the midst of the hurricane. And one of those is our own Micah Holmes. In May, Micah and Caleb and others who are graduating from high school, we presented them with a little gift, and Micah was real excited about going off to Truman State. And instead, the next week, he found out he had cancer, and he's in for treatment all the way until Martin Luther King Jr. Day. The amazing thing about Micah and his beautiful parents and his family is the incredible resilience and faith and care and love he's shown through this whole thing. Micah's kind of a quieter kid. If you don't know Micah, he's a little bit, you know, quieter. And he has just, you know, wakes up in the morning and says, you know what? I'm able to tolerate the chemo. I'm at Children's Mercy with great people. I mean, he's moving forward, and his parents both keep saying to me, you know, we need to lift up the incredible way he is living out through this, you know. I mean, I've known people who have said to me, you know, a good dear colleague who died of AIDS, who many years ago said to me, Susie knew him too, you know, having AIDS is the best thing that ever happened to me. And you maybe expect that from a 38-year-old pastor, but you don't really expect it from an 18-year-old, you know, who's seen his friends going away. And so that ability to, like, dance in the hurricane, right, and to take what you have and just to live with it. And we think about, you know, the ways we can surround one another, the ways we can be signs of hope and peace and live out what we have. And there are days when, again, we're like Peter, we just step out on the boat and then we start to sink. It doesn't really matter, right? The important part is that we're offering who we are and helping to nudge the world a little bit further along. So we remember that it was on the night of the betrayal that Christ Jesus took bread, and after he'd given thanks, he broke it and said, "This is my body, which is given for you. Do this in remembrance of me." And in the same way, the cup after supper, saying, "This cup has been poured out for the forgiveness of all sins. Drink this as often as you do it in remembrance of me." Let us pray.
You greet us with your love in every breath and every day. And as we gather together today around this table, we ask your blessing on this bread and this cup, that whatever storm we might be weathering, whatever chaos might be surrounding us today and this week in our lives, in our world, we might find a moment of peace here together, that we might find a moment of seeing something beautiful in ourselves and in one another. And as we join at this table, and ask your blessing, we also pray the words that Jesus taught us. Our Creator, who art in heaven, hallowed be your name. Your kingdom come, your will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our sins, as we forgive those who sin against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For yours is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever. Come and feast.
Some of them were dreamers. Some of them were fools who were making plans and thinking of the future. Some of them knew pleasure, some of them knew pain, and for some of them it was only the moment that mattered. And on the brave and crazy wings of youth, they went flying around in the rain, and their feathers once so fine and tattered. Buildings keep our children by. sky. Some of them were angry at the way the earth was abused by the men who learned how to forge her beauty into power. And they struggled to protect her.
Christian, could you turn up the room mic, both in the room and on Zoom? I hope it won't mess us up. And then I want to invite children who are getting their backpack keychain today to come up. So you can also do it next week if you didn't bring your backpack. Sorry, I'm weathering the cords here at the moment. Or you can totally just take one home too. So there's like not any rules. It's kind of your challenge, your choice. So come on up. Do you guys want to come get your keychains? Keychain time! Oh my goodness, how exciting! Do you want to pick one of these? They're all different colors. Yes, pick one of those keychains. I know, I want them all. My daughter tried to get all of them. I was like, nah, ma'am. Are you girls coming to get keychains today? Yeah, Tate, you're gonna get your, oh, stay up here. Come back. Get one of your keychains. And you can pick one and then pick a different one later, too. That's all right. You want to come get your keychain today? You ready? Okay. You want to put these? Okay, so then we're going to do a prayer together. So stay right here with me. So we're going to do a prayer together for the backpack keychains and for the backpacks. And also, you know what? For you all, as you're starting your school year, it's so exciting, and we can't wait for you to have a wonderful, wonderful year. And we also know that school is hard. So here's what we're going to do, and this is why we turned up this microphone right here. We're going to invite a group prayer. So this is our prayer that's going to take us from church into, oh, my bad. I'm just messing everything up. It's fine. We're fine. Okay. So I'm going to invite you all. We'll start the prayer. And then you'll know your cue because I'll make it really obvious. But just a one or two word prayer of what you hope for, what you pray for our kids for this coming year. So we're going to listen to the prayers of all the folks surrounding us. And at home, we invite you to say yours out loud as well. So, all right, let's pray together. Oh, loving God, what a beautiful thing it is to have schools to go to take our backpacks filled with our hope and our books and our markers, and to go learn and have fun and make friends. And as our young people go into this school year, we pray so many blessings for them. We pray all of the following blessings. This is your cue. Wisdom, joy, peace, so much fun, friendship, new friends, adventure, safety. We pray all of these things and all of the feelings that are in our heart that we just can't find words for. We thank you for these wonderful children. We hope that you help them know your love and our love surrounds them always. In your name we pray. Amen.
If you're able, please stand and sing out like the with your inner camper.
Feel free to do the motions.
Yeah. Give me peace on earth.
Give me love, give me love, give me peace on earth. Give me light, give me life. Keep me free from birth. Give me hope, help me cope with this heavy load. Trying to touch and reach you with heart and soul.
God, who brought creation out of chaos, invite us to step out of our boat, whether we're on a bench, wherever we find ourselves, to offer what we can, so everywhere we go, we might be peace and wage peace and love one another.
Every single other.
Amen.